strong faculty and strong students build universities. And today we're going to celebrate the success of a faculty team that has connected their basic research knowledge to applications that are important to our society. So today we're here to announce a $1 million grant from the Department of Defense to study the effect of radiation on micro-mechanical computer memory. This project has, obviously, military applications, and it also has civilian applications. For example, in nuclear power plants, this would be an important project, as it would be in situations where we're exploring space. So this is a collaboration between the University of Louisville, researchers and students at the University of Louisville, and their counterparts at Vanderbilt University, who are working with us as we try to determine exactly how much damage radiation does to micromechanical memory and what can be done to address this. So to talk more about this research, I have today with us a faculty member from the Speed School, Dr. Bruce Alfanar, who is the University of Louisville's principal investigator on the project. Dr. Alfanar, besides being an outstanding educator, is also a fabulous administrator. He's the chair of our electrical and computer engineering department, and of course, he is also a world-renowned researcher. He holds the university research scholar position in nanotechnology, and he's going to tell you a little bit more about the work that has been funded by the Defense Department. Bruce?
Okay, thank you very much, Neville, and thank you all for coming out this afternoon. So for the last few years, my colleagues and I in the Electrical Engineering Department have been studying micro-electro-mechanical systems, or they're better known as MEMS. That's the acronym for that. MEMS are miniature devices that have mechanical moving parts in addition to having some electrical functionality. So this is in contrast to all of your computers, the guts that are inside your computers. They're miniature electronic devices, but without any moving parts in them. Some common examples of MEMS devices that you might have heard of are the accelerometers or acceleration monitors inside your cars that tell you when the airbags should deploy, the miniature microphones that you have in cell phones and in laptops, and also the micro mirror moving arrays that are used in digital light projection systems. So the work we did here at the University of Louisville in MEMS was mostly on MEMS for sensing applications. So we were interested in sensing temperature, pressure, gas concentrations, vibrations, that sort of thing. And we recently got interested in using MEMS devices for memory and logic applications. So what is a memory device, a normal type of memory device that you have in your computer? So a computer uses electronic-based memory, all right? That means you have lots of electronic charge that's stored on many different small capacitors, millions of them, in fact, inside of your computer. Each one of those little capacitors stores one little chunk of information, so that's a bit of memory. If there's charge on the capacitor, that bit state would be considered a 1. If there's no charge on the capacitor, that bit state would be a 0. Now, you can imagine easily how a mechanical device could also function as a memory. Say I have a mechanical lever here. If the lever is pointed to the left, I could call that a bit state 1. And if it was pointed to the right, I could call that a bit state 0. But there's a number of reasons why electrical memory is much more popular than mechanical memory. Okay, first off, electrical memory is much cheaper than mechanical memory. It's also much faster to use. You can erase memory and write memory very quickly with electrical memory. And also, it's much smaller. You can fit a lot of memory into a small amount of space. But there's one disadvantage to electrical memory, and that is it gets affected by nuclear radiation. Now, if a nuclear particle hits this electronic memory, it generates a big cloud of charge, all right? And that charge can get the memory confused between the charge that's already being stored to store its one bit of information. Now, that's not a problem here in this room because there is no nuclear radiation, fortunately. But if you're in outer space, or if you're next to a nuclear power plant where an accident has occurred, or if some terrorist has come along and set off a dirty bomb and a lot of radiation is there, then your electrical memory has a good chance of failing. And that's exactly when you might want that electrical memory to actually work instead. Now you might think then mechanical memory is a good option, right? Because mechanical memory doesn't use electrical charge to store the information. It uses the mechanical motion of this cantilever beam or some sort of mechanical object. All right, and that's what we thought as well, so we got interested in studying the effect of radiation on these types of devices. But the fact is, no one really knows what's going to happen when radiation impacts these MEMS devices. And so that's what we got involved in trying to put together this research project. Now here at the University of Louisville, we have lots of experience with making microfabricated devices. We have a top quality microfabrication facility, which is one of the top in the country, and we have years and years of experience in making these microfabricated MEMS. But unfortunately, we didn't have experience in doing the radiation exposure. So what we did was we looked around and we noticed that, well, just south of us in Vanderbilt University, they have the Institute for Space Defense Electronics. And there they have a lot of experience in studying the effect of radiation on electronic memory devices. So what we did was we called them up and we said, hey, we want to study the effect of radiation on MEMS. Are you interested in this project? They were. We had many meetings. We had discussions. We wrote proposals. We gave talks. We wrote more proposals. And in the end, we eventually were successful and managed to get this $1 million of funding from the Defense Department through the Defense Threat Reduction Agency, or DTRA. We're very excited about this project. We've already gotten started in building devices. Just last week, I was in Vanderbilt doing some radiation tests there, our first radiation tests. And we're excited not only for understanding the effect of radiation on these devices, but also for the likelihood that we can develop a type of memory device that will withstand radiation in these types of situations, scenarios, outer space, or if there's a nuclear accident, or if there's some terrorist attack. So this is a very important research that we're really looking forward to pursuing. So I'd like to next introduce John Usher. He's our dean of the Speed School in Engineering, to also say a few words.
Thanks. I want to echo previous comments and welcome everyone here. Thank you for coming out. I want to thank Bruce and his team for pulling together what is a very significant project. It's a great example of the type of university collaboration and collaboration with our government agencies, Department of Defense. What's happening now is that companies, organizations around the world are realizing that you can't have all the smartest people inside of your own organization. And so that the only way to really get large projects done is to collaborate. Now, I find it a little bit ironic that about 2 months ago, we were not collaborating with Vandy. In fact, our student rocket team was competing against Vandy's student rocket team. And Vanderbilt won that competition by the thinnest of margins, and Louisville came in second. So out of about 40 engineering schools, both Vandy and Louisville did very, very well in that competition. So where our students were competing, our faculty are now collaborating on a space-related activity. The other thing I would like to say is that this activity is a great showcase for our two associated centers, being the Micro Nanotechnology Center, MNTC, here at Louisville. That's our 10,000 square foot clean room facility. It's world class. It's in the top 25 of all clean rooms in university settings in the United States. They have unbelievable capabilities, and so this is a fantastic way to showcase this. And also the ISDE, that's the Space and Defense Electronics Institute at Vandy. This is a fantastic facility with great faculty and leaders who are involved in this project. So I think the folks associated with those two centers are also to be commended for having those centers up and operational and equipped and well-staffed so that when an opportunity like this comes along, we're able to take advantage of it. And it's a perfect example of why the university, both universities, invest in these types of facilities that can be shared and used for faculty collaboration.